sets to the hospital and some of the conditions of how we treat that patient once the patient is in the hospital. So I want also to include a few things at the beginning. For those that don't know, David Drogan is the chairman of the department, and Dr. Reddy is the program director for the residency. So he's in charge of the residents. And we have, our residents are either four-year training program or six-year training program, including a the MD degree with a certificate. We have, for those that don't know either, we have an undergrad clinic and where we can do deep IV sedation for some, you know, most of the procedures in our clinic. And we have residents and faculty working together for these cases. This is the this is an old picture from our grad clinic, but it's pretty much the same. Hopefully in 2020 we'll have the new building. We have also an operating room in our area where we do general anesthetic for patients that are very, you know, healthy, ASA 1. We do like from orthognathic procedures to other complex surgeries. But like I say, have to be, you know, an ASA 1 patient because we don't have all the equipment like people who run in the hospital. Then we have the undergrad. I am the clinic director for the undergrad, and you probably don't see me much there, but anything that goes wrong is my fault. Everything that goes well is Dr. Rogan's. So I just go, I'm in charge of whatever all the complaints that we have in the undergrad clinic, including all the PPE equipment, and now I form part of the committee to make sure that we follow the rules in the entire area of our service. So the grad and undergrad clinic are my responsibility for being compliant with all the PPE equipment and make sure that you guys stay safe by not, you know, sticking your, you know, yourself with a needle or things like that. So even if you don't see me, I'm probably just trying to make sure that we follow the rules with even the faculty. We have part-timers that are being here for probably 20 years and difficult to manage and have somebody to change their mind when they've been doing something for so many years the wrong way. One thing I want to say here is that everybody's familiar with the dirty window, right? So across the dirty window is Dr. Jorge Gonzalez's office. And he's the director of the CMP clinic. I don't know if you're familiar with that either, but it's the Center for Maxillofacial Prosthetics. And it's also on the same hallway we have our clinic. It's just on the other side of the hallway. And we try to keep his, you know, the front of his office as clean as possible, even though we had a dirty window right in front of his office. Something that we have to keep in mind is I don't want to see gowns, like clean gowns or, you know, anything disposable that is clean in terms of, you know, for that object to go into the red beans, it has to be like damp and gloved. So, and I don't think you do those kind of surgeries here in clinics, hopefully. So just keep in mind that to dispose the red beans is very, very expensive. Because it has to be, you know, the regulation by OSHA, they're very strict and they have to be disclosed in a, yeah.
Does surgical tubing go on the red one?
No. You could, it doesn't, it's not that bulky, but, you know, you usually are using, you know, irrigation with the surgical tubing, so it's not like there's a, you know, big clot of blood inside the tubing. If that's the case, yes, I will say yes, but if you know, usually that's not our case, so yeah. And the gloves, you know, I do the gloves because there's, I mean, really, there's blood in the gloves, so, but not, you know, if your gown is just a little bit just stained with some blood, that's not necessary. One thing that is gonna come up in a few days is people with very long hair and heavy hair. It's gonna be an issue, but I want to make sure, and the school wants to make sure that you don't take home saliva and blood in your hair, and then you go to your bed or you go to your kids, and you kind of spreading the box everywhere. So people without, with people with very long hair, I'm talking about, you know, long hair, like, you know, down here, either female or male, we're gonna have to go up with some kind of way of getting that hair, it may be, I don't know, in a ponytail or something that is not really everywhere. And it's not for us, it's for your protection, so we're not trying to, you know, be picky about it. The other thing in the undergrad clinic is people, you guys kind of want to rush it, and you start pulling the blood cups from here, the tubing from here. Well, this area here breaks pretty easy if you do that. So the correct way will be to change it from this area here. So you untwist this and switch it to the other cup. This, if we break this, we have to buy the whole thing. It's like $80. So we don't have this, you know, we have the new ones from OB, but still, if you switch it from that, you know, area here, it's gonna break pretty easy. Don't remember, don't leave the oxygen or the nitrous open, because we're gonna just, the next day, it's just gonna be gone empty for the entire school. Okay, so the Baylor Hospital, we are attached to the hospital. We are, this land is the hospital. We rent it for like a dollar. That's the agreement that, you know, a very, very old agreement, but we still do. So we're not part of the hospital. We, as you know, the oral surgery department work for the hospital. We don't get paid either from the hospital, but it's been a very good relationship because the residents get the training they need over the hospital, and they get to do all the surgeries in the hospital. They get to be on call and learn everything about emergency situations. But the hospital, we have a good reputation at the hospital, and this has been, you know, a long history with the hospital, and different hospitals work in different ways. So we are a totally separate entity. The dental school, the dental department is a separate entity that it is like any other department. So you have the dental department here, you can have probably the general surgery department, and you can have plastic surgery department, but some other hospitals, the dental surgery department is a subdivision of the general surgery. We are not, we're totally a separate department, and we just guide our, you know, our guidelines, of course, following the guidelines for the hospital. But we have gained a reputation where sometimes ENT is not, doesn't feel comfortable doing, you know, a few things, and they call us. Remember that we are coming from, you know, a past history of being the dental people, and we have gained the territory by knowledge and experience. So, you know, when we go to the operating room, we get respect as well as any other department in the hospital. So any ENT or any trauma surgeon or any plastic surgeon or any orthopedic surgeon, so we have a separate entity that is being very well respected. These are all numbers. Like, I don't know how many beds Parkland has now because they have a new hospital, but in downtown area, Parkland and Baylor are the primary hospitals, the trauma one level hospital. And if the patient is not taken here, it's taken to Parkland, where there is a big, let's say, a patient that has been pretty risk of death. Something that probably Dr. Clementine is gonna talk to you about is like, we can have dentists with privileges in the hospital. And believe it or not, you will be part of the team treating a patient that might have, you know, medically compromised situation, medically compromised, and they will need some dental treatment. So either the oral surgeon and the dentist can be part of that patient that is going to be admitted to the hospital with some very advanced medical condition. We see patients with any of these problems, so medically compromised patients, including pre and post organ transplant patients. Usually we get a consultation saying this patient is going to get a liver transplant, this patient is going to get a heart or a kidney transplant, and we need to evaluate this, you know, the mouth and see if the, you know, the condition of the teeth are okay, because these patients are going to be medically depressed, so her immune system is going to be depressed for the rest of their life because they have an organ transplant. So there cannot be any infection in the mouth that will compromise the transplant. So the either sometimes when we're lucky, the patient's lucky, we get a consult right before the transplant, but sometimes we get consulted after the patient, after the fact that we had the transplant, which is, it kind of, you know, makes the situation a little bit worse for the patient because we are working now with, you know, compromised, totally compromised patient. We see trauma patients, any motor vehicle collision, you know, any, like, you know, patients ejected from the car with multiple fractures. We saw the fractures last week. Chronically facial pain, TMJ patients, phobic patients, mentally, physically challenged patients, cleft lip and palate cancer, and other patients. So we see pretty much everything related with the, you know, from the clavicles up at the hospital. And I say clavicles up because sometimes there are neck injuries that general surgeons don't feel comfortable treating, and so they call us to manage the patient. So why we are having these lectures, because you as a dentist, you know, that you can have privilege in a hospital where your practice is going to be at. And you can have either, you know, provisional privileges, which means, you know, you can have a, you know, 4x, you know, a patient, and, or you can have an active privilege to see patients at that hospital, okay? And there's different different classifications that you can be associate, you can be have courtesy, for example, for one patient that you're going to see, you can just request courtesy non-member credentials. And consultation is just only for one single situation, you can have just a consultation credential membership. The hospital chart. So it's a little bit more complex than what you do here at the school, but it's very similar in a summary, because you're going to follow pretty much a physical and history of the patient, so evaluation of the condition of the patient, and what we call HMP, which is history and physical. There are going to be forms that you have to fill out, so what you want the staff to do with the patient. What kind of diet the patient's going to have? What kind of exercise can the patient get out of bed? Can the patient will need assistance to get out of bed, or patient needs somebody to walk or do physical therapy outside the room? All those orders are going to be part of the chart, and you're going to decide, you know, from the diet to the exercise to what kind of restrictions they have in terms of you know, food, people in the room, etc. So depending on the mental status of the patient or the physical condition of the patient, you are going to decide what the patient is going to do. So you can do verbal orders, so I can call and say, hey, I want the patient to have an aspirin, or I want the patient to have something for pain. But guess what? Then you have to go into the system and sign all those orders. So you can still do over the phone, but you still have to go and sign. For us, we have 48 hours to sign any orders or any dictation that we do for that patient. And if you don't sign, you're going to get, you know, email saying we're going to put you on the B list, which is like the blacklist. And depending on how many times you've been on the blacklist, they can take away your privilege at the hospital. So it's very difficult because we see a lot of patients, but we have to keep track of that too. So who needs admission? What kind of patients are going to need admission? Well, depending on, like I said, you know, the mental status of the patient, children medically handicapped. We, Dr. Triplett and myself, we cover some surgeries that Scottish Rite children. We have full privilege over the hospital, Scottish Rite, to do to treat kids with a lot of mentally compromised patients. So they have from cerebral palsy, you know, patients that really are not with it. And so parents, you know, being taking care of these kids, and we have to go there and, let's say, you know, take away some teeth or sometimes like supernumerary teeth. They have a pretty good treatment because there's a dental clinic at the hospital too. So we do everything under general anesthetic at the at that hospital. Same thing here. If we have a patient that is not mentally, you know, taking good, taking his own responsibilities to sign, we have the guardians to sign consent. Physically a handicap also, high-risk medical conditions, you know, like severe cardiovascular or pulmonary diseases, and medical emergencies like trauma, severe lung injury, infections, et cetera. So we have also pathologies that we're going to, benign or malignant pathologies that we're going to treat also over the hospital. Those things, you know, when you have a, you have to manage those patients, you cannot do like we do here under IV sedation. They have to be over the hospital, they have to be under general anesthetic. So what's in the chart, what's in the hospital chart? So we're gonna have patient identification. For those patients that have been or committed a crime, the patient, the real patient's name is not gonna be in the chart. So in case somebody wonders if we come to the hospital looking for that patient name, they're not gonna be able to find it because we know the patient, the real patient's name, but it's not in the chart. So that way they cannot find a patient in just in case it's just like a, you know, a games kind of situation. So we're gonna have written orders, verbal orders, like I said before. The progress notes have to be daily. We have to make sure that we see that patient daily in the morning and in the afternoon to make sure that we are updating the situation of the patient. Patient was, let's say, in a pretty bad condition, and we have to make sure that, you know, we're changing maybe the diet, the medications, or we're changing everything we need to change during the day. So we check on them in the morning, and we check them at night. Make sure that we have to order labs or any radiographic studies. We also order through the chart or by phone. And summary of evaluation, treatment, current status has to be in the chart also. And if we're going to start discharge the patient, we have to dictate the discharge note. So everything we do has to be in the chart. It's electronic, but we have some form still on paper at the hospital. So once the patient gets here, we have admission note. So you have to say why you are admitting the patient. You have to have admission orders. You have to have orders written after surgical procedures. History and physical, like I said before, and informed consent. So patient, for example, I had a situation the other day and it's about informed consent. So before surgery, you take consent from the patient is 18 years old or older, okay? But let's say you are in the OR and the patient is already under general anesthetic and you need to do something else that is not in the consent form. So you as a doctor, you can tell the family what you want to do. You're gonna modify the consent while in surgery. You can tell the family, but since the patient is an adult, the patient is asleep, they cannot sign the consent. What you do is you use your judgment to do the best for the patient, okay? And you try to minimize any possible complications, but you're gonna have to use your judgment and do the best you can. And then of course, just, you know, explain the patient what happened, but unless the patient has a legal guardian that can sign for the patient, which is, you know, what we usually do, but if not, you have to modify that, do your best. Admission note is gonna have the reason why you're meeting the patient. Let's say, number 30 has an abscess, and it's got, you know, facial swelling. You think that it's an submandibular abscess, and you do your diagnosis. Plan for hospital treatment, so what are you going to do with the patient? The patient's going to be taken to the operating room for incision and drainage and extraction number 30. Written by the physician, doctor, resident. So anybody that is going to treat that patient has to have, you know, have to write a note in the chart. And usually, written in progress notes is like, you know, the word in your, like I say, every day, twice a day, you have to write your progress note, how the patient is doing after your procedure. It used to be like that, but it's still, you have now templates that we have in Axiom to fill out and write your progress notes on the patient. Admission orders is going to be, it's going to, you know, have all these steps here, and it has to be always like that. It's going to have, like I said, you know, allergies, vital signs, activity, nursing instructions. Sometimes, you know, we have instructions like, you know, irrigate the catheter where we did the drainage of the tube, and then, you know, keep a gauze in there and check it three times a day. Diet, you probably have the, you know, the patient on soft diet or blended diet or liquid diet, depending on, you know, how much the patient can chew. You have to figure out, you know, how much fluids you're going to give the patient if the patient is not eating a full diet, and then what kind of medications you want to have the patient on, and what kind of tests you want to have every day for that patient. So here's your form for your orders. It's going to have a date, an hour, and you have to initial that, and same thing, you know, either on paper or over the phone. The nurse is going to write your order, and then you're going to have to sign it electronically. A history of physical has to be done by the doctor, the resident, or whoever has the privilege of treating the patient. May be completed within a reasonable time prior to admission. So you're doing an evaluation of the patient. Let's say working on history, you're evaluating, you know, the past medical history, you're evaluating the condition of the patient, and you have to do that before the admission of the patient, so 7 days before. This is if the patient is not an emergency situation. This is just somebody that you want to admit to the patient. And some abbreviations are permitted on the consent or the progress notes and the physical history, but there's not too many that are permitted, so you don't have other personal confused with your abbreviations. So this is your HMP, what we call HMP is history and physical, and you have to have vital signs, you have to have labs, you have to have evaluation of the whole head and neck region, review of the systems in your history and physical. This is just an example of what we write in history and physical. It's a little bit more extended what you do here in the school, but it's pretty similar to what you do every day for a patient. It's going to have your labs and any comments that you want to have at the end for diagnosis. Informed consent, I think I already talked about pretty much what I want to say. You gotta tell the patient the risk, even though if your surgical procedure is going to include possibly death, you have to tell the patient that. Okay, it's not like, oh, I'm gonna sound bad, I'm not gonna tell them. No, either the anesthesiologist have to talk about their risk, you have to talk about your risk too. So if that includes possible, you know, fracture when you're working on the mandible, if the patient's gonna die from maybe, you know, a liquid angina, which is, you know, infection, you know, from one side to the other. Anything that you think is going to be a possible complication, you have to go over with the patient. And it's gonna have a witness, it's gonna have a date, it's gonna be signed by the witness. So you always have three people. You have the patient signing the consent, you have you explaining the patient, you sign, and then the witness, usually the nurse and when I meet with the patient, will sign that consent. And this consent is not electronically, of course, because it has to be signed by the patient and be signed by the nurse, by me. So basically, this, you know, when it says I voluntarily request doctor, it's going to be have the doctor's name there. So the patient understands who's the doctor and what we're going to do with the patient. Usually you go and say, do you know what we're going to do today for you? And they have to understand in their own words, what are we going to do for the patient? That's very, very important, okay? Same thing here when you're going to work with the patient. They need to understand what you're going to do and they need to understand the risks and the benefits of what you're doing. So it's nothing different, it's just a different type of, you know, template that we have. For the daily progress notes, we're going to have, like I said, we're going to see the patient. Sometimes the whole team cannot go, but at least one, or I mean, at least two people from the team are going to go and round on the patient at least once daily if the patient is not in acute stress, once daily, and then you're going to write your physician progress record. And the format for the SOAP is going to be, SOAP is just a mnemonic to remember. SOAP will be for subjective findings. So patient will say, I have pain or whatever concern the patient has. Objective findings are going to be your, you know, your vital signs, any exam findings by you. So anything that is new or you can see on the patient that is a, you know, a sign of what's happening. And then you have the A for assessment. So the patient is stable, improving. What you can, you know, conclusion you can have from your findings. And then for last will be the plan. So what are you gonna do with the patient? You're gonna start doing physical therapy, you're gonna advance the diet, you're gonna, whatever you're gonna do with the patient and the discharge plan. That's the progress note paper. On the operative note, if you're going to do surgery on the patient, you have to have this template and you have to go over every single step on this operative note, because if you wanna, if the patient comes back to your office, you wanna see what you did, you're not gonna remember, you know, on every single patient what you did in the operating room. So you have to have an operative note for every patient, where it's going to the see details. Let's say when the patient had a mandible fracture and you use a, you know, a brand, specific brand for screws and plates. And you choose that and you use it, let's say, you know, from Stryker, for example, which is a, you know, very well-known company. And let's say you have to go back to remove the screws in about 2 months for a complication. So you don't know what kind of system you use, they're not going to pull the right screwdriver, and it's not going to fit on the screw. So it's going to kind of complicate your surgery because you did not put it on the nose in the past, so you're not going to remember what system you use. Sometimes you can tell by the x-ray, but sometimes it's really difficult because all the plates kind of look the same on the x-ray. So you have to be very detailed on what you write here, so if you have any complications in the future, you can go back and say, okay, I remember I did this, I ligated a, you know, an artery, or, you know, with this type of plate, and, you know, so you can go back and read all the details. Whoever is the consultant must have hospital periods, like I said before, and you can request, depending on what you think you're gonna be doing with the hospital, you can request your different type of privileges and be part of the hospital. Some hospitals will pay you to be on staff as a general dentist. So, you know, there is an opportunity for you to be there, and you're probably in the hospital you're gonna be, but close by. For labs, you know, there's a different type of, you know, labs that you can order. Basically, or the basics are going to be CMP, which is a complete metabolic panel, a CBC, which is going to have your white count, your red count, And then any coagulation studies that you wanna, you know, find out about. ECG and chest x-ray usually for patients that are gonna be not healthy, and you're gonna need those for general anesthetic. And any miscellaneous, you know, if you have a transplant patient, you're gonna have to order some specific, more specific labs. The discharge paperwork, you have to have a note on the discharge too. Whatever is the patient, let's say you did surgery, a mandible fracture, and you want the patient to exercise the opening, you gotta write all the instructions step by step, so the patient gets that those instructions by the time they go home. So you have to dictate also that and make sure you say everything that you indicated to the patient before they leave. This is a discharge note, an example of that. Very detailed again. And you know, with those discharge notes, the patient will know how to, you know, when to follow with you in the clinic and what kind of, you know, medications, possible complications, when they have to, you know, what number they can call, talk to you, and have any you know, extra questions for you. Good? Yeah, easy? Okay, so next week, spring break, I'm gonna work on, if I have time today, because I will be starting with a lab, anesthesia lab with the D2s today, so they're gonna be injecting each other starting today. So if you wanna have fun, you can stop at the clinic this afternoon. But I'll see you after spring break, but I wanted to post the results for the exam midterm today, and I think I will do that around maybe lunchtime or after lunchtime. Okay. Enjoy your break. I'll be here.
Necessarily, yeah, I think so too. Like one time in your career where it didn't matter.